Ovo je 566. Al Jazeera svijet. Ja sam Azra Hadžić u emisiji Ove priče. Lična ispovijest Izraelca koji protestira protiv vlade svoje države. Uprkos ličnim gubicima, poziva na rješenje koje isključuje rat. Dopisnik Al Jazeere sa sjevera Gaze o prijetnjama izraelskih obavještajaca, ubistvu oca, rušenju doma, gladi, masakrima i nepokolebljivoj volji da nastavi izvještavati o genocidu u pojasu. Kakva je stvarna situacija u Sudanu godinu od početka rata? S terena nam pojašnjava dopisnik Al Jazeere. Mladi izraelski aktivist Gil Dikman protestira protiv Netanjahuove vlade i sa sve većim brojem sunarodnjaka zahtjeva da se preispita rat protiv Gaze. Vjeruje da je dogovor s Hamasom jedini način da se okonča ubijanje i vrate izraelski zarobljenici. Za njega je situacija lična. Tetka mu je ubijena 7. oktobra, a za rodicu se nada da je među živim taocima. U narednim minutama kratki film Izbliza pruža uvid u duboko podijeljeno izraelsko društvo, dok je sve veći broj Izraelaca bijesan jer im se čini da se njihova vlada sveti umjesto da ispuni obećane ciljeve. U gotovo 7 mjeseci rata protiv Gaze Izrael je ubio više od 34.000 Palestinaca. Dikman kaže: "Stid je preblaga riječ da opiše ono što osjećam zato što nevini ljudi s obje strane moraju plaćati cijenu za ono što rade njihove vođe."
Maybe that's the wake-up call, because we thought that we can live if we just shelter ourselves and go to safe rooms and go where we go, and then we'll be fine, and we don't have to find a solution for this.
So we got the news that 2 hostages were rescued in a military operation. The military pressure brings only dead hostages, or maybe 1 hostage that was brought.
I hate the fact that people are right now dying on the other side of the border. There is a small number of families. They are against any kind of a deal, and they think that the IDF should go all the way and then we'll have the hostages somehow.
Strategy is to just keep going into the committees and talking there.
Shalom.
No, you're fat. Wow, I'm out of here. What is it?
כי אם יש אנשים, אזרחיות ואזרחים, תינוקות, זקנים, גם חיילים, גם חיילות, מכל סוגי הישראלים שנמצאים עכשיו בצרה ואנחנו לא מצילים אותם?
אנחנו מוכנות לתת את כל מה שיש לנו, שזה החיים של הילדים שלנו שנמצאים ונלחמים, ואנחנו בטוחות שהם עושים את הכל, כי הם בטוחים שזה הדבר שיחזיר את האהובים שלכם כמה שיותר.
במבצע המדהים שלו נמצאים בתקופה.
The most important thing is making sure that Israel is a society that chooses life before revenge. And that's a hard thing to do, and you have to make sure that nobody paints you as if you are serving Hamas. If we don't work wisely, we might lose life. Shame is a too small word to say how shameful I am that innocent people on both sides of the border have to pay the price for what our leaders are doing. My mother grew up in Barrie, and I was visiting that place since I was a few months old. We know that Gaza is right there. I never felt scared. For me, it was just like heaven.
It's a John Steinbeck.
The Grapes of Wrath.
Here, there was a big TV and two sofas, here and here.
Kinneret would be in the kitchen, and immediately I would go, and we would serve the food for whatever occasion this is. And after a while, and everything's on the table, and so Carmel would come down the stairs. Kinneret would always make sure that when Carmel comes, she has like 3 bottles of this milk, so she wouldn't miss her coffee. Carmel loves her coffee.
You know, looking at all these ruins, I think I could never believe that that was actually a home where life was lived. No place on earth should look like this. Not here in Israel, not in Gaza.
I wake up every morning and I think maybe today.
Really?
Yes, every day. I'm looking for my phone, seeing if there's a deal going on, every day.
It's not only a question of when, for me now. It's a question of whether.
Maybe something horrible happened to her. Maybe she's alone right now without any other hostages. Maybe she died.
This demonstration is against this government.
Many of them are responsible for many of the bad things that happened that day and that happened since.
I didn't vote for any of the parties sitting in this government. But in a way, I have to believe that the government can bring a solution that'll bring the hostages back home.
See this? This is the first kidnapped posters. And this is actually my aunt. She never left the kibbutz alive. She died there.
I was here with my aunt and with my cousin
demonstrating against a government leading us towards a future in which it's a continuous war.
A piece of land here or a piece of land there, it's something that we can learn to exchange. But we have to learn how to trust one another again and how to forgive one another again for everything that happened.
Više od 6 mjeseci izraelske snage u Gazi ubile su više od 130 novinara, što je najveći broj u nekom sukobu u modernoj historiji. Uprkos teškim uvjetima i ličnim gubicima, novinari ne prestaju upoznavati svijet sa genocidom koji se provodi u Gazi. Jedan od njih je naš kolega Enas El Sharif, koji nije želio napustiti sjever pojasa, iako je primao prijetnje od izraelskih vojnih obavještajaca koji su zahtijevali da prestane izvještavati i da ide prema jugu. Budući da ih nije poslušao, uništili su mu dom i ubili oca. Ni to ga nije zastrašilo, niti pokolebalo da nastavi raditi svoj posao.
هذول معاشرهم منطقتي وحارتي هذول يعني انولدت انا معهم ودائما معهم هنا فبينهم عايش وبعيش اطباعهم بعيش كل حاجه معهم ايش عمل للحجه ايش في بديل تعبت كثير وفش جميع يعني مش قادر اجي. طيب الابر الانسولين بعوضا عن هذا؟ وكمان فش انسولين. فش هو بس بعوضا يعني بدي احاول ادور له. بعوض بس ما فيش انسولين. المشكله انه الانسولين كمان. يلا يا سيدي الله يفرجها يا رب يعطيك العافيه. طبيعه عملي انا في الاصل مصور صحفي. لكن خلال تغطيتي للحرب على غزة أصبحت مصور ومراسل وممنتج ومحرر. الحرب هذه ما توقعناها بالدرجة هذه بحجم الدمار اللي إحنا الآن بنعيشه وحجم المجازر صراحة ما توقعنا. السلام عليكم حمزة. وين حدوم؟ ايش اخباره؟ يلا يلا اما اما وين ستك؟ طب ناديها وتعال. والله هذه الدار واقفة واقعة يعني بالمعنى انه احنا مخاطرين وقاعدين فيها. يعني الاضرار كلية هي 4 طوابق الاضرار كلية بالكامل لكن واقفة مسنودة بدور الجيران مخيم احنا بدور متلاصقة ببعض. فبس واقفة هيك. يعني هيك زي ما انت شايف طلع العمدان ها. العمدان الرئيسية تبعات الدار كلهن مع القواعد. كلهن من الدمرات مع كل ضربة مع أي مطر مع أي كذا البيت بيهتز برج كذا لكن ما فيش أي مأوى يعني فيش أي مأوى زينا زي حال الناس وفيش أي إمكانيات نعمل أي شيء فبالتالي أجينا رجعنا على البيت المقصوف يعني رغم الخطورة يعني كانت كل التغطية منذ بداية الحرب وحتى هذا اليوم عبر هذا الهاتف طبعا نقلت في هذا الهاتف جميع المجازر جميع جرائم الاحتلال اللي ارتكبها بحق الأهالي بحق المواطنين في شمال قطاع غزة.
الآن نرى جديدة على نفس المكان الذي نتواجد فيه. الشظايا الآن تتساقط علينا بكثافة في هذا المكان. الآن غارة جديدة بجانبنا على منزل جديد.
يا الله يا الله
العصومي يا الله أهلا أهلا بسم الله
حسبني يا أخي حسبني.
طبعا في محيط مستشفى الشفا قاعد هان في الشارع قاعد بحاول أدور على نت عشان أكمل خاطر. يعني بتلاقيني بروح على عمارة بتم بيستهدفونا بنروح على مكان تاني بيستهدفونا. طبعا كل يوم بتم تعطيل جوالي بتم تعطيل كذا بتم يعني يوميا بوقفوا لي الشرايح يوميا يمكن بدي 5 شرايح للإنترنت بس عشان أضلني مستمر في التغطية. الصوت تقطع. كان في يوميا علي اتصالات من جيش الاحتلال الإسرائيلي يوميا يجيني اتصالات ما أرد نهائيا. ففي النهاية أجاني رسائل على الواتس أب برضو ما رديت عليهم. في النهاية وصلني من ضبط المخابرات تسجيلات صوتية أنه يا أنس الشريف اترك التغطية شمال غزة وتوجه للجنوب وإلا يعني سيتم يعني استهدافك. هو صراحة الشمال ما ضل الشمال فيش حياة في الشمال. جوع اللي احنا فيه هالقيت الجوع يعني انا وثقت كل شيء من مجازر ومن دمار ومن شهداء من مصابين من اشلاء يمكن ما تأثرت قد ما تأثرت الان انا بمرحلة الجوع اللي احنا فيها لان انا بعيش زي الناس بتعيش زيك زي الناس. انت الان بدك اكل عشان تقدر تستمر في التغطية تقدر تقف على جسمك تقدر تسند نفسك ما فيش اكل وانت في العمل بتفكر ايش بدك توفر لاهلك طيب فيش لهم توفوا، فيش إيش توفوا. طبعا حتى غير معاناتي مع الناس، الناس اللي أنا بصور فيهم بعيش معهم بتأقلم معهم، صرخاتهم في الجوع أصعب من صرخاتهم في المجازر والدمار. كانوا يعني المجازر والدمار يصبروا عليهم لكن ما صبروش على الجوع. الآن أنا بوثق يوميا حالات وفاة الآن قاعدة بتصير من الجوع. صراحة الحرب كلها صعوبات وكلها تحدي يعني، وكلها مجازفة يعني، مجازفة في التغطية وفي العمل وفي الاستمرار. لكن في بعض المواقف اللي كانت هي صعبة جدا يعني علي، كنت أغطي الأحداث في مخيم جباليا. كانت قوات الاحتلال تقدمت من المناطق الغربية للمخيم وقامت باعتقال عدد كبير من النازحين في مدارس الوكالة. بعد نصف ساعة وأنا يعني بتابع في التغطية والتقرير هذا من بث، جاء لي ابن أخي الشهيد مصعب فببلغني بيقول لي قصفوا بيتنا. فأنا توجهت يوميتها مباشرة يعني أبحث عن والدي، فما تمكنت ما بصل منطقة السوق والمدارس اللي هم الجيران والناس جايبين لوالدي على عربة الحصان.
استهدف الجيش الإسرائيلي منزل صحفي قناة الجزيرة أنس الشريف في جباليا ما أدى إلى استشهاد والده.
ومجرد انتهاء مراسم الدفن خرجت على القناة، على قناة الجزيرة، ونقلت الحدث اللي هو الحدث الأصعب كان عندي، فقدان والدي وفقدان منزل عيلتي.
قد كشف قبل نحو أسبوعين عن تلقيه تهديدات من ضباط إسرائيليين لوقف تغطيته الحرب الإسرائيلية على القطاع.
وين يا بابا؟ سلم
سلم عليها.
فقررت البقاء وعدم المغادرة نهائيا من شمال قطاع غزة. هكذا عائلتي لم تغادر مخيم جباليا ليوم واحد، بقيت في مخيم جباليا ولم تغادر، وأنا بقيت مستمر في التغطية. والذي حفزني أنني لم أغادر هو كما تحدثت الأمانة التي كانت في عنقي، هي نقل معاناة أبناء شعبي في شمال قطاع غزة. الأمر يعني إحنا بنتحدث تقريباً أكثر من 130 صحفي استشهدوا خلال الحرب. يعني هذا الأمر بيديك إنه أنت خلاص وقف عن التغطية، أنت صار الاستهداف مباشر للصحفيين، تكلم عن 130. الاحتلال بيحاول إنه يكتم الصوت، ما ننقل الصورة. لا عاد إحنا بدنا نكمل الرسالة من بعد زملائنا الصحفيين، إنه لحتى اللحظة الزملاء مستمرين في التغطية، ما توقفوا، سواء في شمال غزة، في مدينة غزة، في خان يونس، في دير البلح، في رفح، ما توقفوا لحظة واحدة. وهذا بيديك إنه إحنا مش بس بننقل المعلومة، إنه مجرد إنه إحنا بننقل المعلومة، ما إحنا جزء من معاناة الشعب، وإحنا جزء من الشعب، وإحنا المعاناة اللي بيعيشها الشعب سواء من الجوع، من القصف، من المجازر، إحنا عايشينها إحنا وأهالينا. فبالتالي إحنا لما بننقل معاناة الشعب إحنا بننقل معاناتنا، إحنا بننقل وضعنا، إحنا بننقل معاناة الجوع، إحنا بنموت من الجوع كنا وما زلنا، إحنا بننقل اللي إحنا بنعيشها، المعاناة اللي إحنا بنعيشها.
Godina je rata u Sudanu. Približno 10 miliona Sudanaca raseljeno je zbog borbi vojske i paravojnih snaga za brzu podršku. Država je u opasnosti od toga da u njoj nastane najveća svjetska kriza gladi i raseljavanja. A ipak jedva da se pojavljuje u naslovima medija. Dopisnik Al Jazeera Malcolm Webb vodi nas kroz konflikt za koji mnogi kažu da ga je svijet zaboravio.
The conflict in Palestine, in Israel, in Ukraine, the upcoming US election are among some of the things that seem to have pushed the conflict in Sudan further down the world's agenda. And that's visible just from the lack of support for people there in the transit camp. And also politically, the lack of international pressure on the warring generals in Sudan to come to the table. So it's going on and causing a massive humanitarian catastrophe. I'm Malcolm Webb, I'm a senior correspondent. Sudan's often been described as the world's forgotten crisis. We went there, and between us, it's tragic. The rapid support forces in the army have turned against each other. The generals leading them, both vying for power. That has forced about 8 million people from their homes. About 18 million people are facing acute food shortages. The conditions had just got so bad that people were left with little choice but to flee. And one of the only places they could flee to was southwards. So a lot of the people arriving in the town of Renk had very long journeys. Some of them had fled multiple times. A lot of the people that we spoke to had tried to hold out to, you know, keep their property, their shops or their homes, and survived through most of a year of fighting. But then things had got so bad that they decided to flee. At the same time, many of the displaced people don't want to leave the border area because they don't want to have to rebuild their lives in remote, long-term refugee settlements in South Sudan. That's just one of the reasons why the transit camp is just growing bigger and bigger, because they hope that things will get better soon so that they will be able to return home. But from what we know of the conflict in Sudan and the stalled progress of peace talks, that doesn't seem very likely. When you're on the ground, you do get the feeling that it's a forgotten crisis. Firstly, the lack of humanitarian support given the numbers of people that are passing through Renk, the numbers of people that are displaced, and then from the humanitarian workers there, you get a certain sense of exasperation. You get this sense that this is really bad. People saying that they'd also survived fighting but were getting hungry in their homes because they were cut off from essential supplies, including food. And people just aren't paying attention. You know, like the world's not getting it. One woman's son, she said, had been detained and beaten and interrogated by the rapid support forces. They wanted him to join. Eventually, the commander released her son. She was said that that was the last straw. They sold their last possessions, borrowed some more money so that they could get on a bus, head south to the border. We barely saw any other journalists. One plane brought in journalists one day and took them away again the following day. And we were lucky to have a whole week on the ground. Because in such a situation, there are many things that you don't get to understand until you've been there for a few days or you get to meet more people. One afternoon, we were filming in the transit camp, filming some of the very basic shelters there, which are kind of made of tattered plastic sheets and rags. And a young man came up to us. His name was Mohammed. He said that he'd been there for almost a year. He was one of the first people to flee when the conflict started. But just before he fled, he'd completed a university course in journalism, and he was really excited to see us there in the transit camp with a camera doing doing our work. So we ended up hiring him. We worked with him a little bit over the following days. In spite of having lost everything, having lived in a house made of bricks and come from a family that could afford to send him to university, now living in a shelter made of tattered plastic sheets and depending on humanitarian aid to get by, but that hadn't dented his ambitions one bit. He was determined to keep going and to tell the story of what happened to his community and to others in an environment where there's much to be sad about, which can be really quite depressing at moments, to find someone who is, I guess, so bright and so determined and so unfazed by the circumstances. It's inspiring. In the worst crises, you get glimpses of the very best and the very worst of humanity. It's a real lesson in human resilience.
Na kraju smo još jedne emisije Al Jazeera Svijet. Sve naše sadržaje potražite i na portalu te YouTube kanalu. Do narednog susreta, doviđenja.